Insights from the world's best medical minds. You are watching therightdoctors.com.
Dear friends, today we are talking about a problem that has overwhelmed the world and the subcontinent, the diabetes mellitus. In our country alone today, there are 720 million subjects with diabetes. And all of us have known that if you look at the current, apart from hypertension, cardiac disease, diabetes is one of the comorbidities that predisposes to a severe clinical disorder in COVID infection, and mortality is quite a bit higher from a non-diabetic population. Today, it's a pleasure having this conversation with a very senior colleague, a physician, a diabetologist, an endocrinologist, Dr. Anil Kumar Vermani. And we will fundamentally be talking about some of the shifts in the paradigm, the way we handle diabetes in the contemporary world. In the last half a decade, there have been many changes, and there have been a huge change in the therapeutic armamentarium that is available with us for managing this disease, which has become a major global issue, not only a healthcare issue, but an economic issue, because you need a huge amount of money to treat this disease, to treat its complications, the cardiac disease associated with it, the renal disease associated with it, the eye disease associated with it. Now, what are these major shifts in the paradigm of treating diabetes, particularly type 2 diabetes, which is far more commoner than type 1 diabetes, in terms of protecting our heart, cardiovascular disease, heart failure, kidney disease? We know that diabetes has huge comorbidities, and that comorbidity is manifested literally in every aspect of in every system of the body. Today, you know that a huge correlation of diabetes and kidney disease to such an extent that the commonest cause of chronic kidney disease globally today is diabetes. So I would like Dr. Vermani to continue on that paradigm shift in managing diabetes.
Thank you, Dr. Zagar. It's a pleasure to be here today with you. And regarding the paradigm shift in the management of type 2 diabetes, I would like to go back little in time in the early 2000s when the UKPDS and the ECT trial told us about the HbA1c as a marker for the complications of diabetes. The primary aim at that time was to reduce HbA1c. So we were basically glucose-centric. And to reduce A1C, we went to the extent of conducting trials with intensive glycemic control. And as you remember, the three trials, the ADVANCE, the ACCORD, and the VAT trial, were done with intensive glycemic control. In fact, the ACCORD trial had to be prematurely terminated because of increase in mortality. So at that time, we realized that only being glucose-centric would not work, and we have to manage hypoglycemia. And then around that period, in the late 2000 and early 2010, 12, 13, we became hypoglycemic-centric. We wanted to minimize hypoglycemia. In 2015 came the EMPA-REG trial, and that totally revolutionized the way we looked at patients with diabetes. Two things happened. One, the American Diabetic Association realized that we had been barking up the wrong tree. We had been now to become complication-centric, because we had drugs which could prevent cardiorenal complications, and as you rightly said, kidney disease, one of the commonest complications of diabetes. So we have now become complication-centric. And the second thing, the treatment has become totally individualized. Individualized approach depending on the duration of diabetes, the presence of comorbidities, life expectancy, individual characteristics, needs, treatment responses, costs, and of course, the renal functional status. But this is definitely not the end of the story. In the near future, what we are looking at is reversal of diabetes. And in fact, we have already started talking about it, that if we can attack this deadly disease in the early stages, within 5 years of the onset, by intensive treatment, when patient is healthy, otherwise apparently healthy with no comorbidities, hit early, hit hard, then possibly we can not only delay the complications, but reverse the disease. And then maybe in distant future, we might even think of preventing diabetes. Now, if you look at the current guidelines, they are the latest guidelines because, as I said earlier, we have become complication-centric and we have now drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1 receptor agonists, which we will be talking about. In a patient with a known atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, now it is almost mandatory to prescribe a GLP-1 RA or an SGLT2 inhibitor. In patients with CKD, we know SGLT2 inhibitors are preferred. And also in patients with heart failure, SGLT2 inhibitors would be preferred. But we must also not forget that we need drugs to minimize hypoglycemia, minimize weight gain, and perhaps at times also look at the cost factor, because in our country, it is not possible that all the patients will be able to afford these costly drugs. Now, in the latest guideline of the European Society of Cardiology, in association with the European Association of Society Study in Diabetes, they have put SGLT2 inhibitors above metformin, which we had never thought earlier. And metformin was one drug which has always remained the first line of drug in the treatment of diabetes. But today, its hierarchy has been threatened by a drug which can prevent cardiorenal complications. I think that is a big paradigm shift. Now, your opinion, Dr. Dalga, please.
I think, you know, if we look back over the last decade, a lot of changes have occurred in the management of diabetes in view of the evolving therapeutic armamentarium. I think what my friend Anil just now was talking about is something that has been happening in the recent years. And I'm sure that in years to come, with better data coming in, we'll have a better understanding of how to prevent those complications. But if we look back for the last one decade, you see, I've been an endocrinologist for almost four decades. And for most of that period, the only therapeutic intervention that we had available with us was insulin, sulfonylureas, and metformin. And hypoglycemia used to be a huge challenge till only these drugs were available. Gliptins came with a great relief a decade back, particularly taking care of two things. One, hypoglycemia was far lesser, and two, they were weight friendly. They may not have been as good in reducing weight as SGLT2 inhibitors. But with our decades of experience with insulin and sulfonylureas, where We were so scared of hypoglycemias. We were so scared of that weight gain. Even when the reasonable euglycemia was achieved, gliptins came with a huge relief. Now, we have an experience of a decade, and we have also known that they have an amazing activity, at least in the Asian population, Eastern Asian population, and South Asian population, and subcontinental population. It has something to got to do with some of the genetic predilections we have, which predispose us to anteroinsular excess defects and deficiencies. And many people believe that, even though, you know, Anil would bear me out, most of the time as we have been talking about a hemoglobin A1C of 0.1 to 0.7 to 0.9. But a lot of Indian data says that it could be even up to 1.2. So they have meaning this class of drugs is pretty good in a huge number of patients. One, number two, hypoglycemia extremely rare. Number three, there is no weight gain. But more importantly, the safety profile is excellent. I'm so like, literally in anybody, you can close your eyes and start a gliptin. The only problem was with a couple of gliptins, there was a signal of an increased heart failure. But there are much better gliptins available and relatively cheaper available, as Anil was telling, that cost will continue to be an issue in the Indian subcontinent, in our country, continue to be a major issue. Affordability will be an issue. So from that point of view, gliptins have really stampeded the Indian market just because of their safety profile, just because of their cost, because now the cheaper ones are also available. And safety, you know, as age grows, EGFR goes down. As the duration of diabetes grows, EGFR goes down. So from the hypoglycemic point of view, SGLT2s might have a bit of a problem because they may not give that optimal control if the EGFR goes below a particular level, but in very elderly people. But gliptins are a class which in a structured manner can be given till very late to people even with a reduction in EGFR. So huge prowess there, because probably one of the best things to take care of complications would be to give an excellent glycemic control, to give an excellent blood pressure control and dysglycemia control, dyslipidemia control right from the word go. I would here ask Anil, you know, because he raised the question of these SGLT2s, which are amazing drugs. He also said that there are certain guidelines now which are given it a preference in at least in a particular class of people who have either a cardiovascular disease or a huge factors that predispose them to coronary artery disease, or a very, very strong family history of coronary artery disease in at a younger age. Benefits were known. Are there any problems also associated with SGLT2s that we need to educate our colleagues with? Dr. Anil.
But before I go to SGLT2, one word about DPP-4 inhibitors, as you just talked about the gliptins. I think in lighter vein, I would say this would be the only anti-diabetic drug that would be approved for telemedicine consultation for the first time when you're prescribing to a patient, even without seeing a patient. They're so safe, just to endorse what you have said. Okay, now coming to SGLT2 inhibitors, we know the benefits are enormous. The reduction in hospitalization for heart failure is a tune of almost 35-36%. The reduction in the renal outcomes like end-stage renal disease and the reduction in albuminuria is again very impressive, to the tune of 36-45% with all the three SGLT2 inhibitors that we have today, that is the EMPA, DAPA and the CANA. But it was only empagliflozin that also showed a very impressive decrease in the cardiovascular death and a decrease in the three-point MACE by almost 38% and 19% respectively. But having said that, I always say that these drugs are like a beautiful rose, but they have got thorns, and they have to be used very judiciously. I don't want the story of britazones to be repeated with SGLT2 inhibitors when they were used randomly at high dosages, irrespective of whether the patient was in heart failure or not. It is very important to use these drugs when the eGFR is more than 30. We have to see and rule out history of recurrent urinary tract infections and genital mycotic infections. The patient has to be educated that he should remain well hydrated. He should maintain a meticulous genital hygiene, and in situations of fever, stress, or infections, he should immediately consult his doctor about the dosages of these drugs. So education is the most important thing. But I think the most important is shared decision making, and that is very vital. We have to educate the patient with all the benefits as well as the side effects of the drug so that he knows when to take it and when to stop it. Yes, Dr. Zagar.
Put in, very aptly put in, that there are certain caveats, and that's why, you know, it has now become customary to educate that you have to, because now the basket is growing so much, you have to customize your management to the requirements of the patient. And in that customization, when Anil was talking about, he just now alluded to coronary artery disease and heart failure and kidney disease. And he also referred to the heart failure data, which unambiguously shows that literally all glyphosates reduce remarkably the incidence of hospitalization for heart failure. In a similar fashion, a new class of drugs that we have been using for some time are GLP-1 receptor agonists. These GLP-1 receptor agonists, if there was some data that came with a trend-setting molecule in that segment known as liraglutide. The cardiovascular outcome study with that was leader, which again shows that given in time, this particular molecule can change the natural history of the coronary artery disease in diabetics and can, in a big way, lower the chances of developing a cardiovascular disease in patients with diabetes. Not only with later data came with dulaglutide, you know, once dulaglutide available, how salutary effect or affectionate effect it had on the heart. And now we are getting amazing data from semaglutide, daily oral semaglutide, weekly ones, how it impacts the cardiovascular health. So that basket that Anil and me were used to is getting filler, and making the choices rather difficult for us. But I must tell you, given the fact that there are, see, like, you know, liraglutide, let me talk about it. So if there is a problem of genuine diabetes with cardiovascular disease, or you want to prevent it, this becomes a drug of choice. I'm just like, you know, it has its own caveats, cause some nausea, some gut symptoms, in a similar fashion. So we have to sit together with the patient and customize it. But two things that need to be understood. I'm happy that Anil, in fact, in his first opening remark, only mentioned it. Sulfonylureas, we have been using it for a long time. And today, we do not use the sulfonylureas that I used to use in the 80s. Thiazolidone, dionys, we don't use today, rosiglitazone. But I have been using pioglitazone ad libram. And in fact, I have been a fan of that particular molecule. And alpha-glucosidase inhibitors are their own role. Given the role of all these good molecules, what would you summarize as a current status of these molecules in a country like ours? Let us not bother about rest of the world. Let us talk about the subcontinent. Let us talk about India. Anil.
I agree with you. When I started my practice in diabetes way back in 1977, if you remember, we had only tolbutamide and glevenclamide and metformin. And in fact, we have used glevenclamide till 5 years back. Now, those sulfonylureas did have a very high incidence of hypoglycemia. But currently, the two modern sulfonylureas that we have, especially glimepiride and gliclazide, especially gliclazide modified release, both have proven to be cardio-safe, the gliclazide in the ADVANCE trial and the glimepiride in the Carolina trial. We know that these are very potent drugs. They are affordable. And in fact, more than 80% of the patients in our country are on sulfonylureas, and these two sulfonylureas. And they have a wonderful A1C reduction, and they give excellent results, and they are well tolerated. So I think they have a place to play, especially in a country like ours. Now, regarding the glitazones, we had a controversy with rosiglitazone. The bio also went through a roller coaster ride. But when we analyze the pioglitazone molecule, which I also am big fan of, you look at the proactive study, there was an absolute risk reduction of 2%, and the number needed to treat is only 50 patients for 3 years to get a reduction in the major adverse cardiovascular event. The IRIS trial also showed that even in patients with insulin resistance but without diabetes and history of TIA or ischemic stroke, there was a very significant reduction in stroke and myocardial infarction. But more important, there was a reduction in progression to diabetes by 52%, and that's a whopping figure. So pioglitazone, especially in the dose of 15 milligram, I think it's a wonderful drug if used judiciously, and one has to be very careful to rule out early signs of heart failure. Of course, it has got its side effects like weight gain and pedal edema and history of fractures. So better to avoid in postmenopausal women or in patient who has a history of fracture or he has history of breathlessness or dyspnea on exertion. So these are the patients that we should avoid. That is one thing about pioglitazone. It's a wonderful drug, there's no doubt. Alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, again, for the Indian patients, because we have more of postprandial hyperglycemia, our carbohydrate content in the diet is almost to the tune of 65% to 70%, whereas it should be around 50% to 55%. So we need these drugs. They are wonderful drugs in controlling the postprandial hyperglycemia in Indian patients, especially. Over to you, sir.
I think, Anil, you know, I think most of the areas have been covered. I think one important area that people will be looking for today is role of diabetes and management of diabetes during COVID times. And I think that is something that we cannot neglect today, wherever we talk, whatever we talk. Whether diabetes is the topic or not, I think it will be sort of a dereliction of our duty. So, because a lot of scare has been spread around it, even I said, you know, diabetics have some of the issues. But I must say first, you know, for the sake of our own audience, that as we keep on saying that 80 to 85% of COVID patients are asymptomatic, and that would hold true for diabetics as well. And in most of the diabetics, whatever therapeutic management, whatever lifestyle, diet, exercise has been prescribed by the doctor, even during these COVID times, lockdown times, you know, or sometimes, those instructions should be adhered to. Because whenever we are talking about the bad outcome in a disease, it invariably is in that segment of population where disease has not been properly taken care of. But these are the times, you know, when patients or subjects with diabetes, individuals with diabetes, should take particular care of their diabetes. Once in a while, do not sugar. In the last decade or two, a lot of people have now got used to getting glucose estimations done at home using glucometers and different devices. And monitor it in case there is a hassle. they need to be in contact with their healthcare provider and talk to them, telephone them, and look at the common signs and symptoms of respiratory tract infection, particularly if a diabetic has any, let's say, sneezing, running nose, cough, sore throat, or some form of a dyspnea, malaise, and now recently loss of smell and loss of taste have been documented with COVID-19. If any of these things happen, they should immediately, without feeling scared, knowing that most of the people will do well, even staying at home, even if it is COVID, talk to their doctor. And probably, you know, only rush to the doctor or to a health service if there is a very high temperature. If there are of a lower respiratory tract infection, characterized by chest pain or severe asthma, I would look at the last word on this from my friend, because this is something that we need to talk about ad librem, so that people understand. On the one hand, they need to take care, but on the other hand, no scare should be spread around diabetes and COVID-19. Over to Anil.
Right. I 100% agree with you. And first of all, the fact remains that patients with diabetes have inherently reduced immunity. So they have a tendency to acquire this infection. There is no doubt about it, especially those who are uncontrolled and elderly or staying alone in the house. On the other hand, the infection, COVID infection itself, leads to more severe infections in patients with diabetes, more chances of hypoglycemia, more chances of diabetic ketoacidosis, more chances of new onset diabetes, and a lot of complications. There is no doubt about it. But having said that, studies have shown that if there is good glycemic control, then 99% chances are there that the patient is not going to face any major problem. That is a big booster. So my advice to these patients is basically, first of all, please maintain an open communication with your healthcare provider, whoever he is. Number two, always keep all your medicines, take your medicines without fail, have a nutritious diet, do regular exercise. And I think this is one time where we can hammer the idea that every diabetes patient should have a self-monitoring of blood glucose and a home blood pressure monitoring. These two things are very necessary. And in cases for emergency, they should also keep a pulse oximeter at home. I think these three things are more than sufficient, and they must be educated about the signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia, and especially in type 1, how to look for their ketosis. I think these are very simple things which can be done with education, and we need not be afraid of this disease if the patient can keep his glycemia under good control.
I think, you know, Anil, before we sign off, one word is extremely important. You know, we have talked about literally all the drugs and given a general overview of. But one thing must be understood, that insulin treatment in diabetes is extremely important. And that has changed the outcome in a big way. And there is one drug that has been available with us for a good part of 100 years. And a stage in the natural history of many diabetics, in fact, most diabetics, if they live longer, if they listen to the doctors, that in addition to either any drugs, combination of those drugs, or independent of those drugs, a doctor might advise insulin to a patient. And just listening to this should not mean that just abandon that insulin treatment and start a drug which is having other advantages, because fundamentally, whenever those drugs are given, they are given to control diabetes. So at the end of a treatment or a longer duration of diabetes when a person has decades of diabetes, many drugs may not act. Even some would continue to act for a long, long time. Some would act for decades. But whenever insulin is advised, we should not show any hesitation. And I can assure you what Dr. Virmani was talking about. Many people who do not have a good outcome would be ones who have been hesitant to insulin therapy and continue to have a blood sugar which is haywire. Many people in COVID, I'm talking of in reference to COVID times, that people have not been rather reluctant to take insulin, glycemia not appropriately controlled, would be predisposed. Or people who have comorbidities, did not take care of themselves in the past, have a cardiac comorbidity, have a renal comorbidity, would have a poor outcome. So let us look at this time positively in COVID times, that diabetic should, it should reinforce us as clinicians and patients as well, that in order to ensure that people with diabetes do not have any associated additional comorbidities or mortality, we need to give them as best a diabetic care as possible. And Anil referred to two important things: monitoring at home blood glucose and monitoring blood sugars. Probably this should become a lot of people have picked it up in the last few decades. But given the mammoth nature of our country, given the so much heterogeneity of our education, given the such variety of our culture, and more importantly, such a huge spectrum of economic availability to deprivation. So wherever it is possible, or to whatever extent it is possible, it should be taken care of. Anil, it was a pleasure talking to you today and to our audience. And I think, I hope, and it made a difference to those who are listening to us. Thank you so much. Stay blessed and stay safe.
Thank you. Stay safe and stay blessed.
Insights from the world's best medical minds. You are watching therightdoctors.com.